Hello, everyone. Welcome to a new episode of Empowering Voices. Today, we have our special guest, Joël. Sorry, I said it again in the French way, but I know that it's Joël. How are you? Welcome. We are very happy to have you here. How are you doing?
I'm great. Thank you so much for having me. And I do love the French pronunciation of my name. It sounds so much classier than in the Yorkshire accent.
Oh, that's lovely. So you all know that I normally start my conversations from the words I am embroidered on my garments. And today I chose for Joël Set Boundaries. This is the t-shirt for all of you to remember, Set Boundaries. And, you know, I mean, the face, the hand painting. And I really would like for you, Joël, to tell us what you do quickly, then we will go into it a bit more along the way, and set boundaries, what you think and if you use them and how.
Brilliant. So thank you for having me. As you said so beautifully, I'm Joël Byrne. I can't say it properly now. It just doesn't sound the same as when you say it. And I'm a business strategist. So I specialise helping small businesses to use passive and semi-passive income streams so that they can set their own boundaries in their life. It works so perfectly for what it is that I do. Because for me, boundaries are about allowing yourself the freedom to be who you want to be and allowing other people to be able to give you the space to do that. So I think it's really important to be able to set boundaries both in your personal life and in your business, so that you can experience everything and have that kind of freedom of time and money and all the wonderful abundance things that we can actually have in our lives. And so for me, it's really important.
Yeah, do you think, because we were talking earlier and I learned the real meaning of boundaries during the pandemic, it was necessary, especially when you have a family, kids and stuff. But I think I found that a lot was to do with me, of course, not others, because they don't even know. I mean, if you are always there for them, they are not doing anything wrong in reality, although you are resentful towards them. But the second you are clear with what you want, it's easier to set boundaries and have an healthy lifestyle, really, with yourself and with others. And I think what you do with your business, it's to take your customers as well to have this clarity and being clear on what is their aim in business, but it becomes also in life. Do you find that when you work with someone, it's not just business?
Yeah, absolutely. There are so many things that are what I would consider general rules of thumb for business, but that actually overlap into our personal lives. And it's things like our own vision of our own capabilities, so what we think we're actually capable of doing. And actually also understanding that if we set boundaries that are appropriate to our business and what it is that we want to achieve there, that those boundaries will naturally overlap into benefiting your personal life as well. But also then you find that, oh, by setting boundaries in my business, I've achieved so much. I wonder what would happen if I did that in my personal life. But I think also when you're self-employed or, you know, a freelancer or whatever terminology you want to put yourself under, I think it's even more important to be able to define the line between business and personal, because it's so very easy to find yourself working until midnight, because you're trying desperately to make this thing happen because it's all about you and you're all on your own. Yeah. I think finding that ability to be able to set the boundaries in both sides of your life can change everything exponentially. It really can.
Yeah, I totally agree, because when you are I didn't realize, I have to say, this year is the first time in 10 years that I decided to have a proper holiday. Proper holiday means that I was off internet for 10 days in a row. That wow. never happened. Yeah.
That needs a huge clap. That's
I have to say there was a little trick. We rented a place where internet wasn't very good. So I was forced to it, but it makes such a huge difference. I mean, I enjoyed the holiday 100%. I got the rest that I needed and I didn't even know. So to be recharged and go back to your business with a fresh mind, with a fresh eyes, with a lot of creativity inside you, just because you took a step back.
That's right? It. Yeah. I mean, the first thing, if you worked in a big company and you rang your IT department because your computer wasn't working, the first thing they would say to you is unplug it, switch it off, and switch it on again. And the chances are it's probably going to work. The same happens with your, you know, your television and your internet connection and your phone and all the things. If it stops working, you unplug.
Yeah,
and exactly. The same absolutely needs to apply to us as human beings. That just that short period of unplugging and actually just getting back to ourselves and not having to focus on anything, that little bit of mindfulness, makes such a massive difference. You know, I only took a week off. We were only here in the UK during the summer, but what it's meant is I was unplugged. My phone was switched off. My daughter was chuffed a bit because I wasn't staring at my mobile,
yes.
You know, constantly distracted on trying to multitask. And it felt amazing. And I've come back to work with a new renewed sense of vigor. And like you mentioned, the creativity, it has to come from that place of peace, I think.
Yeah,
that's so important, and you can't get peace until you unplug.
Yeah, I mean, you need to make space, right? Because otherwise, in your head, there's nothing, there's no space left.
That's it. Yeah, it's almost like I consider my brain to be a bit like a filing cabinet, mm-hmm. and when I try and do my meditations and my mindfulness and my kind of closing down things, especially at night. I'm one of those people whose brain is constantly going with new ideas and what
tell
and
me.
The overthinking. And I think all women are, you know, we do that's what we do. But I pretend that I have a really tiny little man in his little overalls and his hat in my brain, and he goes round shutting all the filing cabinet doors. And that's kind of that's the imagery that I've got in my head. And then he switches off the light at the end after he's done everything. And it's like, okay, we're shutting down for the day. That's it, we're done. And I find that visual, you know, that visual.
Yeah, that's a fantastic image. I think we should, in fact, I normally suggest also my customer to take a step back and work on their mindset to have these vivid images like cartoons or a character in a story, because it helps a lot to take the distance and have a reasoning a bit more like super partes, not too much inside, and then close those drawers at some point and come on, go to bed and sleep now. You need the rest.
And I think we as women, especially from a mindset point of view, we punish ourselves if we're sat doing what we perceive to be nothing.
Yeah.
Or doing nothing, whether that's reading a book or watching television or even wandering around the house, picking up after the other people that live with us. We still feel that we should be sat at our computers working.
Yeah.
And I mean, even if I'm not actually sat at my computer, I could be making phone calls. I could be sat with my diary. I could be sat reading emails in a comfortable chair. Unless I'm actually sat right here behind my desk, I will punish myself because I feel like I'm not working. And that's absolutely shocking. And it's so prevalent that it's something that we need to be able to go, no, hang on a minute. I am doing all these things. Just because I take a nap doesn't mean I'm this horrendous person that can't run their own business and isn't allowed to have that freedom.
Yeah, and sometimes, as you said, reading a book, it's... the opposite, I mean, is the source of new creativity going through your head. Or I take, my inspiration is a lot, I don't know, museums and theater. Yeah. But I always have that little guilt where I'm enjoying it too much and I should be sitting at my desk. And it's not right. Because the best pieces I created in my product-based business came actually from museums, wandering around in a town, or things that people can think is wasting time or enjoying yourself far too much.
Yeah, and it's such a shame that we have those judgments that we pass on ourselves. you know, we pass this judgment that, oh, you know, I'm obviously an avid reader. I have massive amounts of books in my house. You know, my office is built out of books pretty much. I will literally be the old lady who, instead of living in a shoe, I will live in a book.
Yeah.
you know, I would never become homeless. I would be able to build a house out of books. And that is my pleasure. And that is where I find my absolute joy. And in the last 2 or 3 weeks, I've read more than I've read in a really long time, because I've actually forgiven myself and said, no, you don't have to be reading a business book. You can actually go back to reading the sort of, you know, the junk that I really enjoy reading, the urban fantasy and stuff like that. And when I've come back to work after having that little bit of a break and reading those books and taking some time out with my family, I've got this renewed sense of, yes, come on, I can do this, because I am a balanced, I feel more balanced.
Exactly.
You know, that I've got both things going on. So, yeah.
And do you find these often with your customers as well?
Yes, very much so. I tend to find that my customers are massively creative, so they can often come up with ideas, but it's how to put them into practice.
Yeah.
And the same applies both for their businesses and for their personal lives. So they'll be like, oh, I thought I might do this in my living room or whatever. And they'll pass these ideas by me, because we become friends in that sense. You know, we can bounce these creative ideas around. And some of the random conversations I've had with my clients are hilarious. But it means that we get to build that. I don't set boundaries with my clients in what they can talk to me about.
Of course.
Because we build that relationship and that rapport. And it means that often we can bring it back to whatever it is that we're supposed to be discussing, you know, when it comes to the business side of things. But yeah, I think a lot of them will come to me and they'll be like, I'm thinking about doing this. And then we can sort of expand on it together. Because for me, when I'm talking to clients, it's not a one size fits all. It's about you and your personality and your lifestyle and actually what you want. Because it's all right saying, oh, I need some passive income in my life, or I need this to look like this. But actually, if you don't know where you're going, it's like just getting in the car and setting off driving. You're never going to arrive anywhere because you don't actually know where you're going.
Yeah, exactly. That's why we need you.
Yeah, absolutely. And because the thing is, we can go off and create a course. You know, there might be all these people out there that are saying that creating a course is the right thing to do. It might be. And that might be the absolute perfect thing for your business and for your customers. Because the thing is, it's about getting that fine line, that balance between what it is that you want and how you want to achieve that, but also what your customers need from you and how they can access that knowledge from you. So whether it's creating a course, writing a book, building a membership, having a subscription model, using affiliate marketing to be clever about the additional products that you promote within your business, there's so many things that you can do. It's about creating something that's, it's almost like lots of little blobs of clay, and we will come together and we'll build the right thing with the right pieces, and some will get left out because they're not suitable and they're not appropriate.
Yeah, exactly. Because maybe for your personality they don't work, simply not just for your business but for yourself. Because I remember, for example, okay, now I'm on video constantly, right? But before, I mean, the first 2 videos I put on Instagram, it was like I was going really under a surgery, something scary, and I cannot even believe that is the same person. But for example, when you suggest someone to do a course and put themselves out there, it's not always easy, right? So you have to go in steps, you have the knowledge to explain how it will go, what will happen, so that the customer can trust you and then say, okay, I will give it a go, right?
Yeah, exactly that. Because the thing is, when it comes to, let's go with courses, because it's a great example. You could say to somebody, right, okay, off you go and build your course. And the idea of them being on video might absolutely horrify them.
Yeah.
But with some of the clients that I've worked with in the past, they've been makers, they've been hand crafters. And I say to them, your face doesn't have to be on the screen if you're pre-recording this stuff.
Yeah.
You can be a voiceover. You can use your hands. You don't have to do anything live. There's ways of drip feeding things. You can incorporate other aspects of passive income and semi-passive incomes into that, so that you're bolstering the income that you're creating once it's made. You need to then think about the before and the after and the customer journey and all these lovely pieces, because I get very excited about other people.
Yeah, I can see your eyes.
My hands go mad and I start flinging my arms around saying, oh, we could do this and we could do that. But there is definitely no one size fits all for any of it. And like we've talked about right at the beginning, a lot of it is about setting the boundary of what you want to do as a business owner, what you feel as though you can achieve, but also what those customers expect from you. And setting the boundary between what you do when you one-to-one work versus what you might do in a passive or semi-passive piece of work, which is clearly going to be at a lower cost. Mm-hmm. It's going to be at that lower price point. And so I have a lot of clients who want to over-deliver. So they say, right, I'm creating this lovely course, and then I'm going to give them an extra hour here, and I'm going to give them an extra hour there. And I'm going, no, stop, stop, stop. We need to set those boundaries, because the idea behind what we're creating is that you can create it once, and then it will deliver returns for you time and time again. Mm-hmm. That's what it's all about. It's not about constantly creating the same thing over and over and over, you know, in a product, like in a product business. Mm-hmm. If you've got that and it's working really well, that's great. But then what happens when you're maxed out?
Exactly, because especially with a product-based business, that is my case, for example. Yeah. I mean, you have that amount of time, full stop. First of all, you don't do only that, no? Because as an entrepreneur in a small business, you wear different hats. But after that's finished, when you start saying, okay, how many pieces can I produce in a day? That's it. I mean, unless you take other people on board, but that means a lot, another cost, you have to find alternative ways to make money, to invest again in the business in a circular way. I mean, there's no other choice.
Yeah, your income will always be capped when you are directly exchanging your time for money. Now, whether that's because you're spending 3 hours on Zoom with a client doing some coaching, or whether that's because you spent 3 hours behind the sewing machine, you will always only have a finite amount of time.
Yeah.
And you can work out what your income ceiling is by just doing exactly what you just said. So by going in and looking at how many things can I create in that period of time, how many weeks am I going to work, and work it out that in the year you could actually only ever earn whatever that number looks like. Mm-hmm. And then you take away the time that you need to spend doing your accounts and your social media, and cleaning up after the cat, and running around after the dog, and doing all the other things that we have to do as female entrepreneurs. And then we go, oh, actually, that income ceiling that I've just worked out really isn't realistic at all. And so then that's my job. Then I come in and I look at what it is that you do, who you do it for, and how you do it, because they're really important, because that know, like, and trust factor. There might be hundreds of people out there doing life coaching, but actually, why do people buy from you? What makes you special, you unique? Why do people want to come to you over that other, you know, the other 200 people out there that are doing the same thing? And there's always something. There's always that unique selling point. But for me, it's about finding what do your customers want from you, and how can we deliver that in a passive way to make it so that you're making this beautiful thing that's then going to just sell and sell and sell, and you can be on the beach and hear the ka-ching, and it's the best sound in the world. I wish the mobile phone app.
I think it's the dream. But it's the dream of everyone before starting a business, that you are on the beach and the business works on its own. That is not realistic, especially at the beginning. That's why, and also we think that if we have other incomes, other ways, passive ways to make money, we are not very loyal to our business. That is totally wrong. I don't understand why we have this ingrained in our brain, that we make t-shirts, we have to make t-shirts. That's it. That's not true. Everyone, every thriving business has several ways to make money, because otherwise it's impossible. As you said, I mean, the time is that you can earn no more than that. So either you accept the reality or you find an alternative way.
Yeah, exactly. It's like filling the bath. You have one tap running, your bath will eventually fill, but it's probably going to take you a long time. However, if you add two or three or four extra taps, that even if they're just dripping, they're always going to be adding into that pot at the end of the day. I mean, I used to liken it to building a wall. If you imagine your business as building a wall, and you are there with your individual bricks and you are putting one brick on at a time, that's great. Imagine if you had robots running at either side of you, they could be adding those bricks at the same time. It means that not only are you all working together to achieve that bigger goal, but you could actually go off and have a cup of tea And these things are still doing what they're supposed to be doing, because you've got those automations and those things in in process that are going to make sure that it works really well, whether you're there to manage it or not. Mm-hmm. And that for me is not necessarily just about you and building a business and building a brand and making, you know, all the money. It's actually about your customers, because there will be customers out there that want to work with you, but perhaps maybe they can't quite afford to work with you on a one-to-one level if you're a coach, or, you know, they can't quite get to where you want them to be because of time restrictions or logistical restrictions. You know, like you were mentioning before, if you were away somewhere where there was no internet connection, well, you can't join a live course because you don't have the internet connection. So it's about finding ways to overcome those obstacles that your customers are facing as well. So if your customers are logistically impaired in that way, or they financially can't afford what you're offering, what can we create that makes it so that they can work with you, they can access what you're teaching, or they can access what it is that you're creating without having to worry about the funds or the logistics or whatever other obstacle comes in the way?
Yeah, it sounds like the dream, like the dream business to have, really.
It is, and it's achievable. I genuinely believe it doesn't matter what you do, that there are ways and means of adding additional income streams into your business. So a lot of the time I do work with service-based businesses, and a lot of the time that's because they're the ones that are getting maxed out super quick, and they've got their diary and it's full, and now they need something else to reach more people. But actually the product businesses that I work with, there are other ways of doing things. You don't necessarily need to go off and start teaching what you do or how you do it, although that's always an option. But there are other things that you can do that you can enhance what you're already doing. So if you make your beautiful t-shirts and people want to look after those, then it could be that you start becoming an affiliate for recommending products that help to care for the product that you're creating. It could be that you can start drop shipping beautiful packaging that you can keep your things in. It's about thinking outside, I hate the term, but thinking outside the box, to say, right, what's next? What else does my customer need or want from me that's the natural next step for them to take after they've bought my product? Mm-hmm. And how can I make that happen for them? How can I sell those things? And it's not about buying tons of laundry cleaner and sticking it under your bed and hoping that you have to ship that out at the same time. And, you know, it's about doing it in sensible ways, using white labeling, drop shipping, affiliate marketing, all those really clever internet-y things.
But normally when you are in the business, you don't see these alternative ways. That's why you, with the knowledge, experience, and because you are outside the business, can help your clients. Because for me, to be honest, if I think for myself, for me, it's just teaching hand embroidery. I don't see many other ways. Alternatives, but you already gave me ideas, for example.
Well, this is the thing. I mean, you could partner up with jewelry designers who are doing the same thing as you, have the same ethics as you, and are empowering women. So you could pair up with a jewelry designer, and you split the profit 50-50. One, you know, if somebody makes a sale of the jewelry, then they recommend the t-shirt to go with it, and vice versa. Also, you could start thinking about, right, what else do people want? If they're dressing in an empowered way, what other things might they want, you know, on top of that? It's not just accessories. We're talking about clothing and fashion and getting in there with those labels and saying, I want to empower women. How can I promote your stuff? And what are you going to give me in return for that? There's loads of different sort of nuances and things, because we're talking about what your business does, how it does it, and who it does it for. And if you stick to those three really important principles, you can't really go far wrong. But also bouncing ideas off somebody like me or a friend or a business companion, you know, that you can sort of throw ideas around with. Someone who's going to tell you the truth. You don't need a mirror. Yeah. You know, you don't want someone that's just going to be like, that's a lovely idea.
That's lovely. My mum can do that. And that's it.
It's like I've got like three best friends in my life, and I know who I need to go to depending on what problem it is or what it is that I want to talk about. I've got one that will placate me and say, it's okay, everything will be all right, and pat me on the head. I've got one that will tell me the absolute truth and say, well, are you sure about that? And really, you know, throw me the truth. But a lot of the time I can take it. And then I've got another that's very good at sitting on the fence, that being very, you know, methodical and objective and sort of saying, well, have you thought about it like this? Have you thought about it like that? And I think that you need those people in your business as well as in your personal life, to be able to look at your business and say, well, what are you doing that like that for? And not for them to be critical, but to question your methods and why you're doing it. I worked with a really big company 12 months ago. And the first thing I did when I went into the office, this was just pre-pandemic, I walked into the office and there's people walking around with lots of bits of paper hanging around. Now, I like a bit of paper. Don't get me wrong. I love a notepad. However, these people were going to an alternative location, pulling the information that they needed, writing it on a bit of paper, bringing it back to the office, it was then rewritten on another bit of paper and then typed up into the computer to then go off to somewhere else. And I just walked in and I went, what are you doing that for?
It doesn't even look logic.
Yeah. And they just said, because that's how we've always done it. And, you know, a lot of the time that's what I'm up against. So I'll be like, okay, well, have we thought about doing this, like that? And, you know, when it comes to business strategy, it's about the whole. It's about the customer in the first and foremost, but it's about understanding the operations and the logistics behind the way that you run your business. Because even down to silly things like linking your online calendar appointment booking system with Zoom or something like that.
Let's not talk about it. No, because I'm obsessed with the lists and write it down stuff. And literally, I do what you just said. I write the same thing on several pieces of paper. Constantly, I lose pieces. I have two diaries and I don't have a Google Calendar. That would be the most logic and quick way to work. But sometimes you are stuck. Your customers for sure. I can be an example. We are stuck in our habits and we are a bit scared probably to try something new, or we don't even see something new. I remember I told you I'm obsessed with lists. So every morning I had this list, 50 things to do. Constantly, I mean, every day I wouldn't reach even half of it. And a friend said, but have you tried to have a list only of three important things? No, I never did. And when I tried it, I said, I can't believe it. I can even do more than what I used to do. But I was stuck in a habit that wasn't working for me. But I couldn't
say anything. I'm sat here with my diary open. I've got lists.
Okay.
I've got bits of paper, but what I do is prioritize. So I need a master list, because there's always, as women, I think we've always got so many tabs open, we've always got so many things going around in our heads. But I need lists because I feel that sense of accomplishment when I tick something off it.
Yeah.
I work really well. I even write things on a list just so I can cross it off again.
Okay, I'm not the only one. I feel so much
I'm not because it's that sense of accomplishment, it's that sense of doing things. But what I will do is I'll look into business. I'll look at actually what are you comfortable with. So I won't say, right, instead of using this, you need to use Google Calendar and blah, 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 because that's not the way I work. It's about how you're comfortable. Mm-hmm. But if there's something that you're doing manually that's taking time, like let's say, for example, sending out your Zoom links versus when someone books an appointment online with you, they automatically just receive that link. That would save you probably a good couple of hours. And it's a simple link to make on in the back end of the systems that you're using. But what it will do is make you realize, like, wow, I can't believe how much time I've spent sending out these links manually when I could potentially be doing something else with that time. And even if that is going and sitting and having a cup of tea with the time that you've gained back, you know, it doesn't have to be actively constantly working all the time. It's little things that can sometimes make all those differences. But I think it's important to understand how people work, how people are left-brained and right-brained, and some people work differently in other ways. And I mean, I couldn't cope if my inbox was overflowing with emails. I'm very organized like that, but I have lots of customers who have got thousands of unread emails in their notifications, and it makes me go, oh my goodness. But it's what works for them. And so for me, it's about what works for you as a human, what works for you in your business, but how we can make that better and smoother and just kind of trimming off the edges. I think that's the way I try and put it. And also making it so that you've got the time and the money that's coming in to give you the freedom to do all the things that you want to do. And because that's what we wanted when we became self-employed. Mm-hmm. I assume that that's the case with most people.
Yeah, otherwise you would have a hobby. You don't need to become, it doesn't need to become a business otherwise. I mean, if it's called business, it has to make money and give you the freedom to use the money, of course.
That's it, exactly that. And for me, a lot of business owners go into it, they work really, really, really hard to the point of burnout a lot of the time, which sometimes we need to do when we're in setup, when you're in startup. It's important, like you mentioned before, that we wear so many hats. And it is incredibly important to set up well and to do well in those first couple of years, because I think partly for your own mental health, because you feel like, I need to do this, this needs to be successful, because if you're still feeling unsuccessful, which I put in little, invert commas, after 2 years, you start to lose the drive. You start to lose that kind of oomph that you had, that this can work, I can do this.
You definitely lose motivation. That's why many businesses sadly close down after 2 years. It's more, most of the time you can see it would have been going probably very well, but there wasn't motivation anymore. And yeah, I mean, that's why for me it's very important, the mindset. And as you said, if you create a very strong foundations, then you can stay in the unsuccessful stage. That is not unsuccessful. We forget sometimes to see what we were doing 2 years ago. I mean, for me, nowadays I do things that 2 years ago, if you told me, I would have never believed you. Impossible. And we should learn to celebrate every little win and look back a bit more often.
Absolutely. I mean, we say, don't look backwards, you're not going that way. But actually, I think we suffer from comparisonitis in the fact that we compare ourselves to other people that have been at this for 10 years or 15 years or whatever. And actually, what we need to be doing is suffering from comparisonitis for where we were 2, 3, 4, 5 years ago. Yeah. I mean, I was a whole different human being 6 or 7 years ago, completely different.
Yeah, actually, I wanted to ask you, because you had a huge change of career, actually. Yeah. Do you want to tell us a bit how you are a brand strategist today and what you used to do before?
Yeah, so I used to work for the fire service, which a lot of people go, oh my word, as if you used to do that. So I spent just 3 days shy of a decade working for the fire service, and I loved my job, like with a passion that was just, I was making a difference. I was saving people's lives. I wasn't a firefighter, so I wasn't running in and out of people burning buildings or attending road traffic accidents. My job was to work with the socioeconomic side of why fires were happening and to stop them. So I worked in the prevention department. That was my job. And I did everything from going and sitting and holding old ladies' hands in their living rooms and talking to them about how we could make them safer, right through to working with the fire investigation department and pulling together coroner's reports and looking at what had happened after an accidental dwelling fire. And it was amazing and I loved it and I made a difference. And then lots of things happened all at the same time. So within the space of 2 or 3 years, the government changed. So the funding was reduced massively. I had a baby, but prior to that I'd also had an accident where I fell down the stairs and I damaged my back, so I was off work for a while. I was in a wheelchair for a little while. And all of these things all came together and compounded to when I returned to work after having my daughter, I just wasn't the same person anymore. And after 9 months I realized actually I was ill, and it was a friend of mine that said, I think you've got postnatal depression. I think you're unwell. But I don't think it was necessarily because I'd had the baby. I think it was a combination of all
of the many things that were adding up. And
that's it. Yeah. And I was really unwell, in the sense that I genuinely felt like, you know how people talk about mood hoovers, and there's people out there who will just suck away your good mood and they'll just make you feel miserable really quickly. I was a mood hoover. I could find no joy in anything. The things that used to make me belly laugh to the point where I had tears streaming down my face wouldn't even allow me to crack a smile. I had nothing. I genuinely felt like someone had come and sucked the joy out of my world. I was awful to my husband. I was basically a bully for 9 months. And he couldn't understand who this person was because this wasn't the person that he married. Mm-hmm. And I was torn between being unable to leave my child with someone else for a couple of hours and not being able to cope with her at all. She cried for 23 and a half hours of the day. It was just constant. She wasn't a very well baby either. And I was done. I was absolutely done. But not only did I end up with the proper diagnosis of postnatal depression, they also discovered that I had something called stress-induced psychosis, which is fun. It was basically, I had both visual and tactile hallucinations. So when you see things that aren't there, but also feel things, and I used to feel like there were things crawling on my skin. So I feel like there were spiders skittering up my legs, and I would see things out of the corner of my eye that weren't there. Mm-hmm. And so, of course, I said to my husband, I'm clearly not very well, and I don't really know what to do about it. So we went at it, guns blazing. I went on the medication, and I went to counselling, and I went to a psychotherapist, and I did all the things I got more exercise and more fresh air, and I was like, I'm going to get better. And I got, you know,
yeah, that is amazing that you asked for help, because many women don't realize, and maybe they even feel guilty to feel bad, and or they don't ask for help, and sometimes it degenerate and it becomes worse and bigger than the news. So very well done on you for asking for help and doing it all.
But yeah, I mean, it was down to a friend. And again, it was that objective friend that was able to look at me and go, hang on a minute, there's something not right here. Yeah. And I think if you are feeling isolated, if you are feeling that you're having thoughts that perhaps maybe you wouldn't normally have had, or think new, you're having these new thoughts that, yes, as a new mother, you're always going to have new thoughts, I think.
Yeah, of course, you are not used to that role yet, and it's overwhelming. When I had my first baby, we were living in Mexico, of course, far from family, yes, with friends, but it happened when there was the swine flu, that it was starting being a pandemic. Anyway, we were totally isolated with this baby crying almost 24 hours a day. Mm. I mean, it's difficult. And on top of that, for sure, there were pieces of your previous job or whatever that in the moment where we are more fragile, I think, as a new mother, they just come all together. And
they do. And we're expected to carry on with the mental load that we had before. And suddenly that mental load has trebled and quadrupled, because now not only are you thinking, okay, I've got this to do for the house and that to do for the shopping and da 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 da, you've got another human to keep alive. I mean, this is the hardest job in the world. Definitely. And it doesn't matter how supportive your family is, your partner, your friends, it really doesn't matter. You still have that mental load. And that's where making lists and being organized and all that kind of stuff came in for me. And the being organized is the only thing that's really stuck around for me, because I found that that was where I had my sense of power, my sense of control. Mm-hmm. It was the only thing I could control. The fact that I knew exactly where everything was in my house meant that I didn't have to worry about it, and therefore I could focus my attention elsewhere. But I think having these thoughts was really tough. And if it wasn't for the people around me, I wouldn't have survived it. You know, I genuinely was driving to work, planning my own demise. If I just accelerate a little bit too hard around this corner, I'll go through that wall and that'll be it. And I won't have to go to work, and I won't have to worry about whether or not I'm doing
a good job. Yeah, it's sort of feel free and liberated.
Absolutely. And you know that it's bad when it gets to the point where you think that other people would be better off without you. And, you know, that's the thing that I try and just keep remembering, is that I will never get there again, because now I've set boundaries to make sure that I never get to that point, that burnout's not an option for me, because not only could it make me physically unwell, but also it could send me back into circling the precipice of what was the most horrendous time in my entire life. I wouldn't wish it on my worst enemy, but also I am happy to talk about it really openly, because I would never want to think that there was somebody out there going through that who didn't have that one person who said, it's okay, been there, done that, bought a t-shirt,
Totally. For me, the power of storytelling is huge, because the second you find, you don't feel alone. You know that if that person came out of it, you can come out of it. And the postnatal depression is still like seen like a stigma on women. Yeah. I mean, we need to feel guilty for something that is not our fault, to be honest. It's, well, now we talk about it much more than 12 years ago, for example, when I had my daughter. But in, I have two children. In both cases, I never was diagnosed with postnatal depression, but I felt, I mean, maybe in a smaller degree, but I felt all you just said, to be honest, and it wasn't right.
Yeah,
you know that you are not in the right place, but you don't even know how to get out of it. But at the same time, you say, okay, but if I say that I have a problem, I'm a woman who failed. Because you feel that the others will be judging you. You are a bad mother, a bad wife, or a bad whatever. You didn't get there, right? Yeah, like the successful actress that we saw on Instagram 10 minutes ago.
Yeah.
We are very hard on ourselves all the time.
We really are. We are judgmental to the point of destruction. We can be so... what's the word? We are so self-critical that it is destructive. It really is. And it doesn't matter whether we can look at it logically and say, okay, you've never done this before. This is a job that's one of the most important jobs in the world, because you have to keep a human alive. You've never done it before. You've had no training, and there is nobody there telling you, oh, well, never mind, you got that bit wrong. You can't get that bit wrong, because there's a life on the line here. There's a human, and you know, this tiny little ball of person that you made, and you look at them and you just feel like you're letting them down. And I genuinely believe that I would say one in two women at least feel this way. I look around at my friends who have had children since I first had my daughter, and I'm constantly looking out for those signs. I am petrified that they're going to feel what I felt. And a lot of them have made it look really easy. You know, they have this perfect mom thing going on.
Yeah.
And I will often say to them, you don't have to put on a show for me. You know, this is not about who does it best. It's not about whose child is walking first and crawling first and doing all the things.
There's another competition going on.
It's constant competition, and whether it's competition with another person who we perceive to be doing better than us, or whether it's competition in our own minds, I've genuinely got to the point now where I say to myself, I will not say anything to myself that I would not say to a friend. I think that's the best possible way to monitor how kind you are. You know, I would curse at myself for throwing something across the kitchen if I dropped, you know, something by accident. I'd be, oh, you silly mare, or whatever, you know, and you call yourself all these names. Now, those words don't even cross my mind, because I go, uh-oh, what's next? How can I fix this? And that's my natural go-to. And it took some practice. It took time to get there. But I think we have to do that to build resilience in ourselves, in our own mental health, to set those boundaries so that we don't get to that point where we could break again. It's almost like I'm an egg and I'm covered in sticky tape. You know, I'm not going to risk peeling off those layers because I'm not sure quite how healed I am. But there's no need to peel off the layers because I've set things in place to stop me from doing, you know, from overdoing it, from over egging the cake, from giving too much of me to the point where I've got nothing left to be able to look after myself and my daughter and my husband, because they are intrinsically the people I chose to spend my life with, and I want I want to be the best version of me for them as well as for myself.
That's amazing. It really resonated a lot with me, and I'm sure with a lot of women who are now listening. I always tell everyone to come, and they don't need to give explanation, but if anyone needs help, even only to talk, sometimes can make a huge difference to know that we are not alone. Definitely not.
And my door is always open. You know, if there's genuinely, you don't need to come to me. If you want to talk about business, you know, if you've just had a similar experience and you just want to say, do you know what, thanks for that, or you want to have a chat about your own experience and if I can help in any way, my social media doors and email inbox and Zoom calls, they're always open, because I think together we can make such a massive difference. Absolutely huge difference. And it's sometimes, like you say, storytelling and actually just saying what your own experience has been. The power of someone's lived experience is huge, no matter what the topic is, whether it's the hot topic of the moment or whether it's something that, you know, you think should be raised. We should be talking, we should be sharing these things, because it's going to make a difference to someone out there who's listening.
Definitely. So I love this conversation and could go on forever, but I realize. But I just want to ask you one last question. I normally ask my guests if there's a word or a quote that you can identify yourself with that is a bit the support for you.
Wow. Oh gosh. Oh, I love that. For me, freedom has always been a word that's really resonated with me, because that's why when we become an adult, you suddenly realize that you have choices that you never had when you were a child or a teenager, and they go, oh, you're free. And actually, I remember questioning in my 20s, actually, how free are we? How free are we to do all the things that we want to do? Yeah. Because it depends on the finances, and it depends on our, you know, socioeconomic situation, and it depends on our mental health and our physical health and all these things. But actually, all those are choices as well. And for me, making a choice to be free from everything and to be able to make the choices that I want to make, not because someone else wants me to, but because that's what I want. I think that for me is true freedom, about being given the chance to be as free as you want to be, because you've got the chance to make the choices that you want to make. And that's one of the biggest things. I think freedom's a big deal. It really is.
It's an amazing word that can be applied on in any fields of our life, professional and personal alike. Definitely.
Yeah, absolutely. So in work, it's all about, for me, financial and time freedom for my clients. But in my personal life, it's about freedom from the prison that was my own mind once upon a time, and also freedom from what is expected, these expectations. I don't set any expectations upon myself. I don't set them on other people. And I would never, you know, if she said to me, oh, come work for us, we'll pay you however much and it'll be really wonderful, nope, I'm not interested, because freedom for me comes first. And when you are employed by another human being, they're always going to be the priority. And, you know, for me, it's all about that freedom to make the choice and do our own things.
That's amazing. Thank you. Thank you very much for this conversation. I just want to remind everyone that below in the post, in my bio, everywhere on my website, you will find all the details to reach out for Joelle. She offered even just to have a talk. But I really am very interested personally now to find out more about a possible collaboration. I love you and leave you. Thank you again, and see you very soon for the next episode. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.